Imagine this. You've just come back from the doctor, and it turns out your cholesterol is high. You want to lower it so that you can be healthier. Your doctor told you to eat less and move more. But you don't really know what that means. They didn't tell you how to change your diet, and now you're confused about what to eat. It takes up some space in your brain for a couple of days, but eventually, you go back to living like you were before. A few years later, you go back to the doctor for a checkup and find out that you have cardiovascular disease. The doctor tells you that if you don't lose weight, you'll have to start medication. You're overwhelmed and desperate for guidance. You go home and Google diet for weight loss, what to eat to lose weight, how to lose weight. You're hit with over 2 million results each time, and all the websites say different things. You try a couple of fad diets, and you do lose some weight, but you gain it back almost straight away. Eventually, you go back to the doctor and you start medication. Life is busy, so you don't really make any long-term changes to your diet or lifestyle. Sadly, this scenario isn't hypothetical. It's the reality for many Australians, and for some, this story ends in a heart attack. Our healthcare system is overburdened. Doctors and other healthcare workers are busy firefighting the consequences of chronic disease. In Australia, in 2022, chronic diseases made up 90% of all deaths. And as a country, we spend more than $38 billion a year on chronic disease alone. A lot of these conditions, like cardiovascular disease, are preventable. And diet is key. If you don't eat well, you're more likely to develop a chronic disease. Our healthcare system needs a paradigm shift from chronic illness to chronic wellness. We need a healthcare system that prevents disease, not just treats it. But how? I want you to raise your hand if you remember the last time your doctor asked you about your diet. A couple of hands. Doctors are at the forefront of our healthcare system. They're the people who support us in our everyday health. Despite this, doctors get little to no training in nutrition. In a 2021 survey, medical students in the UK reported receiving less than 2 hours training in nutrition. Let's think about that in the context of medical education and training, which can take up to 16 years. 2 hours is not a lot of time, and this is a global problem. What it means is that by the time they graduate, nutrition just isn't front of mind during a medical consultation. And when 11 million deaths globally every year are due to poor diet, every consultation is a missed opportunity. The thing is, medical students and doctors want more training in nutrition. So why is there a gap? Well, that's the question that my research aimed to answer. So I looked at the standards that guide medical education in terms of what is taught from all around the world. And what I found was that less than half of these documents even mentioned diet or nutrition. So it's no wonder nutrition is neglected in medical training. As part of my work, I also wanted to understand the impact of this on the patient experience. And so we conducted focus groups with Australians and we asked them about their experiences with their doctor and nutrition. And what we heard was that Australians want their doctor to be able to help them to eat well. But at the moment, our doctors don't have the knowledge or skills because they aren't being taught how. Like many of you, my experience as a patient in the healthcare system has been challenging. For more than a decade, I felt nauseous, exhausted, I had low iron, and honestly, I was really unhappy. And despite going to the doctor again and again and again, none of them considered that my symptoms could be diet-related. It wasn't until my auntie was diagnosed that I heard about celiac disease, a genetic autoimmune condition that's treated with diet. I was diagnosed, and my quality of life immediately improved. But I wish it was sooner. Fast forward a few years, and this time I'm a teenager in the throes of an active eating disorder. Now, I had been to the doctor a couple of times for a checkup, but none yet had asked me about my diet or my weight. Eventually, and luckily, I found a GP who asked me the right questions, referred me to a dietitian, and followed up. And that dietitian is a big part of the reason I'm here today. A year later, I started my own journey to become a dietitian. My story is why I'm passionate about changing our healthcare system. Every encounter counts. Now, the lack of nutrition education for doctors is a global problem, so it's receiving international attention, including from US Congress. And the good news is that progress is happening. I've seen some amazing examples of nutrition education in medical training from all around the world. And it's not all PowerPoints. Medical students are learning about nutrition by participating in things like cooking classes, student interest clubs, and interprofessional education, where students from different healthcare disciplines come together to learn. And it works. There's evidence that the more that doctors know about nutrition, the more likely they are to eat well themselves, talk about diet with their patients, and refer their patients to a dietitian. Let's imagine together again. What would the world look like if doctors knew more about nutrition? Improvements to diet could prevent one in every five deaths. Doctors are trusted knowledge brokers in our community, and they're often the gateway to other healthcare professionals. Now picture a world where your doctor has the information to give you diet advice for things like high blood pressure, high cholesterol, or even mental health. With this information, we as individuals and communities can prevent diseases and live happier, healthier lives. At an individual level, we have the power to advocate for the healthcare that we want and need. Don't settle for vague advice. Be an informed person and seek out credible nutrition information from someone like a dietitian when you need support. And don't wait until you're sick to take control of your health and well-being. To finish, I'll leave you with a quote. And now its origins have been debated, but its relevance is enduring. Let food be thy medicine, and medicine be thy food. Thank you.